Good morning, everyone. It is so good to see you all. Welcome to anybody who's online signing in. We are glad to have you to worship the Lord with us together today. I got just a few announcements. The fair is coming up, which the church is putting on a carnival during that time. And we have asked you guys to bring some water, cases of water and stuff like that. Can you please make sure we get that within the next 3 days so that we have it ready to go? Also, we had asked if you'd bring some candy that's going to be going for some of the things that they're going to be doing. Some of you have dropped it off at my house, so if you have that, feel free to either put it down in the basement or you can stop by the house and just drop it off. Either way works. Also, just to, yep. So it did get canceled. Okay, so this Tuesday, the Bible study that Sam puts on in Lexington, that's going to be canceled this week. And I'm just going to say, I was about to say it, but here he is. Yeah. As you can see, Dick is here. We are so glad to have both of you here with us. So good to see you.
Well, you guys prayed for a miracle.
Yeah, we got a miracle. Walking proof that God answers prayers right there. And Donna, my mind's going blank. What did you ask me to? Yes, thank you. This Tuesday, though, we are serving meals for the seniors. Again, that's going to be a thing we do every month, every third week of the month. So I do need volunteers again to help serve. At least four volunteers would be great. Yeah, if you can be there Tuesday at 10:45, and then things will get started right around 11, I believe, when people start coming in. Yeah, and so please, if you're willing to volunteer for that, we are going to need volunteers every month on Tuesday to serve meals for the seniors, and this is our Tuesday coming up. So if you are able to do that, please let me know, or you can let Donna or Cheryl or basically let one of us three know, and we'll know the number that we got going on. Was there anything I may have missed? As you can tell, my wife's not here today, so my mind is just bonkers. All right, will you please stand as we open with a word of prayer before we start worshiping today? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great opportunity to gather together to worship you, Father, to lift your name up on high. Lord, I just pray that you would help open our hearts, our minds, and our souls to draw closer to you, to draw deeper into our relationship with you. Father, we love you and we praise you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. Jeremiah 10:6. No one is like you, Lord. You are great, and your name is mighty in power. Seated. Let's read Revelation 4:11. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Thank you. 4:12. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind which is must be saved. John 4:19. We loved him because he first loved us. Story today. To go. You're dismissed to go downstairs.
Yes, no story today.
No story today. Okay. Ha, 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 ha. Hebrews 9:27-28. And it is it's appointed for men to die once, but after this judgment, so Christ was offered once to bear his sins. To those who eagerly wait for him, he will appear a second time, apart from sin, for salvation. Please stand. Today we have generations of fallen away from God, and they are now following other gods. Our morals are declining to a very low. We have a shocking number of adults in our nation that actually need stuffed animals to sleep. Has our nation become too soft? The Philadelphia Inquirer reported that a large number of Americans are coping with anxieties and other related health problems, so they need something to soothe their anxieties for using stuffed animals. Our nation is truly falling away from God. There's a large number of churches today that teach a watered-down gospel. Couples living together that are not being married. Homosexuality is increasing. Morals thrown out the window. Babies being murdered through abortion. This is why our nation is being judged by God, I believe. We need to turn to Jesus and put a stop to all this evil. We need to turn to Jesus. Oh, I'm sorry. Jesus died for us so we can be free from sins. This morning, we remember that he died for us. We come together now to celebrate communion. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thou is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Morning. You know, it's kind of funny. Last Sunday I went through three chapters, and this Sunday we're going to go through four verses. Kind of a drastic change. But let me start with this story. It's from Alec Hill, who wrote an article in Christianity Today, which once told how at age 26, Ken Elzinga joined the faculty of the University of Virginia. After a tenured colleague warned him that being explicit about his faith would hinder his career, Ken was stunned to see that a flyer of his face was on the board, and it was saying he was going to speak on a local part of campus. And of course, it's because he had agreed to the campus ministry that he would speak, and they decided that everybody needs to know this, so they slapped his face up there. The funny thing was, though, is Ken was worried because he was a relatively new believer. And he was worried that, would his fellow professors, what were they going to think of him? Might this harm his tenure chances? He experienced a dark night of the soul in which, during the night, he returned to campus and secretly took down the poster. But the next morning, Ken put the poster board back up. After hours of soul searching, he concluded that his life was not about career ambitions, but about faithful discipleship, and that being private about his faith was not an option. In the four decades since, Ken has been named Professor of the Year multiple times and is still a speaker in high demand. He will be the first to say that serving only one master has been liberating. Why? Because pleasing an audience of one makes us less anxious, less sensitive to criticism, and more courageous. because in doing so, we become more secure and compete less for our own honor. See, Ken learned a valuable lesson regarding loyalty, obligation, and faith towards the Lord that we all must be willing to put at the center of our hearts. Simply put, we all must learn to let God lead according to his will and his timing until we reach our promised land. So in order to help us learn this important lesson, just like last week, we are going to skip forward in Exodus to where Israel is preparing to start their journey to the promised land, in which a very important moment takes place in order to prepare them for their journey. And just like last week, we are skipping ahead because the chapters that lead up to our text for today focuses again on the building of the tabernacle. Now we are skipping ahead, not because I don't think the tabernacle is important, because it's extremely important, but instead our focus at this time is looking at Israel's larger history, their movement specifically, their journey out of slavery from Egypt all the way to the promised land, which means we will be jumping around a few of the Old Testament books in order to get this larger picture. Perfect example is when I preach next, we'll be in Numbers. Probably around chapter 10. That's where the story picks back up. So, I will offer this one more time like I did last time. I am jumping ahead because we're not diving into the tabernacle because also Sam has a Bible study in which he is diving into all these intricate parts of the Bible study, and he's doing a really good job. So I encourage everybody yet again, Tuesdays at 6:30 p.m., not this Tuesday though, you're welcome to come to Lexington and join that if you want to dive deeper into the topic of the tabernacle. So with that being explained, will you please turn with me, if you haven't already, to Exodus chapter 40. We are going to be starting in verse 34. That's Exodus chapter 40, starting in verse 34. Now, we see that God's word says, "Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled on it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Throughout all their journeys, whenever the cloud was taken up from over the tabernacle, the sons of Israel would set out. But if the cloud was not taken up, then they did not set out until the day when it was taken up. For throughout all their journeys, the cloud of the Lord was on the tabernacle by day, and there was fire in it by night in the sight of all the house of Israel." And that's where Exodus ends. So as we finish off Exodus chapter 40, we come to the first key point that we can learn for today, which is that God is both holy and near. So here within the first two verses, we are presented with a final reminder regarding God and his holiness. Simply put, access to the Lord, even by Moses, is not something that can be taken for granted. In fact, the imagery that we see taking place as God comes down and dwells within the tabernacle is an image of God's presence in such an overwhelming way that even Moses cannot and does not enter. But why can't Moses enter? Is it because of everything that happened with the golden calf? Well, no. Instead, Moses can't enter because of the holiness of God as it is manifested in his earthly dwelling place, which is the tabernacle. Basically, what we are seeing is the very real reality that approaching God in his tabernacle is going to be done on his terms because he is a holy God. You see, God is so holy and so perfect in his goodness and righteousness that there is no way for sinful people to just nonchalantly enter his complete presence without protection. We saw an example of this as Moses was on Mount Sinai as God passed by. Moses was not allowed to see all of God's holiness without dying. So instead, the Lord placed him in the cleft in the wall and covered him with his own hand as he passed by, only allowing Moses to see his back. And that was enough that when Moses came down, his face was glowing. But here now, with the completion of the tabernacle, all of God's holiness has come down to dwell in the midst of the people. However, that is not all that we can learn here within these two verses. Yes, God is holy. However, we still learn that he is completely near to his people. God using the cloud and the fire displays that his presence will be with the people every step of the way as he leads them and guides them to the promised land. God is the one in control, but he is not far off. Providing the assurance the people would need to move forward in his salvation plan for all humanity. In the same but even deeper way, we today get to experience God's holy presence as well. However, because we are on this side of the cross and because we have Jesus and his precious blood covering us, we, unlike Israel and even Moses, get to experience all the holiness of the Lord without fear as his spirit dwells within us. Essentially, we as his people are now his living, breathing tabernacle in which God is near to us, living in our hearts as he leads and directs us where to go within this world. God is both holy and near to us. And through Jesus and Jesus alone, we can fully experience both God's holiness and intimacy with him in a new and eternal relationship. I like the way that preachingtoday.com explains this with this short story that says, you might not know the name Angelo Dundee, but you've undoubtedly heard of Muhammad Ali, probably the most famous professional boxer of all time. For more than two decades, Angelino was Muhammad Ali's corner. It was in his corner, literally. He was Ali's corner man, is what he was called. He was the one who made Ali float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. He also trained 15 other world boxing champions. Angelino described his job as a corner man this way. When you're working with a fighter, you're a surgeon, an engineer, and a psychologist. You see, as followers of Jesus, we have something even better than a surgeon, an engineer, and a psychologist in our corner. We have the Holy Spirit who is both holy and very near to us. Continuing on to the second key point for that we can pull from these verses, we come to learn that when God says move, we move. Sounds pretty simple. This concept can't be any clearer than in verse 36 of Exodus chapter 40. Israel was not supposed to be acting on their own initiative. Instead, they were to be all about God and his plans. When God tells them to move, they are to surge ahead as he leads them on. In fact, this concept of obedience becomes a problem later on for Israel as we see them coming to the promised land. God tells them to enter the land and take it. But after sending spies, the people find out that there are giants in the land, and out of fear, they refuse to move forward as God had commanded them to, ultimately leading to 40 years of wandering in the desert. You see, this concept of obedience and submission to the Lord is a constant issue for Israel. They constantly reject the Lord's commands and instead choose to act according to their own will and their own desires. But that is the opposite of what it means to be God's people. Israel was called according to the old covenant to serve and follow God and God alone. This means when God says move, they are to move. They did not enter into a democracy where everyone gets a vote. Oftentimes, we who live in America, we forget this concept because of the way our country's designed. Our relationship with God is not a democracy. Everybody does not get a vote. Instead, Israel entered into a monarchy in which the Lord is both their God, their Savior, and their King. And when you function within a monarchy, you are supposed to do what your King tells you to do, when he tells you to do it, period. Otherwise, drastic consequences were in store for anybody who would reject your king's command. I mean, we see that. They reject God. They say, we're not going into the promised land. He says, fine, you're going to wander in the desert now for 40 years. See, otherwise, things don't work the way it's supposed to. God is our king. today in God's church under the kingship of Christ as our monarch, Savior, and God, we as Christians are called to do the same and be the same type of obedient and in submission to God. You see, each person that places their faith in Christ, each person that joins God's household now has a unique role to play. And when God says move, we must be obedient to move. Oftentimes, you see the churches today, especially in America, that's because we live here and we see everything that's going on here a little bit more than the rest of the world. But today, the church isn't moving as much as it should be. Why do you think society's falling down around us with these immoral ways of living? When God says move, we must be obedient and move. We are all called to play a part in God's plan, and the way he has chosen to move his plans forward is when we as the church choose to be obedient and submit to the Lord by being active when he calls us to be. And within his family, we are called to use our gifts in unity for his purposes. Paul addresses this very point in 1 Corinthians 12, verses 18 through 20, as he says, "But now God has placed the members, each one of them, in the body, just as he desired. If they were all one member, where would the body be? But now there are many members, but one body." So here we see Paul presenting us with this beautiful image of the church, God's family, as a body. And within this image, it is only natural that we would begin to think about all those different body parts that make up the body and that are working together in unity. We would think of the hands, the feet, the fingers, the toes, the ears, the mouth, the stomach, and the list just goes on and on. And you see, all the different parts of the body serve as a purpose with distinct and specific roles in order to make the entire body function perfectly. Paul gives us this imagery regarding the church so that we will all know that the extreme worth God puts and places on each and every person who is now a part of the church. Everyone has a purpose and everyone has a gift that helps the church to function in unity and move forward in the world. God designed the church to work that way, and no one is left out or without worth in his family. Whether you work behind the scenes or take up a more front row seat scene in God's plans, each talent, each gift is needed in order to move things forward. And just like a body, if the parts of the body aren't working properly, then the unity is disrupted. That's why it is vital that when God says move, we move into action, lest the church becomes like Laodicea and just sitting on the fence, lukewarm. We are under a kingship. God is our king. Jesus is our king. When he says move, we move. When God tells us to grow, change, or cultivate our gifts, we must be willing to submit to his will and do what he asks us to do, united together and all for his glory. You know, sometimes this isn't easy because sometimes he asks us to put some real hard work in, to make our gifts better, stronger, so they can be used. Or he wants us to grow. That's always the hardest one. I hate the saying, you can't teach old dogs new tricks. That is a lie, and it does not apply to the church. I don't care what age you are. You could be the youngest child here to the oldest person here. God still has something new. He can teach you and have you grow in. The church needs to not be complacent. We need to be active. And when God says move, we move. We must be willing to submit to his will. But why is unity so important within the church family? Well, because the church serves a purpose. We are to be active in spreading the truth of Jesus and his gospel message. See, Israel kind of forgot that they served a purpose later on. We see that they kind of didn't follow what God had asked them to do. They were supposed to be a holy nation, the hill, the city on the hill that calls all the other nations to them. But they didn't serve their purpose fully. They did bring the Messiah about, but they weren't acting as they ought to have been because they weren't moving when God told them to move all the time. We are to be active in the church. We are to move when God tells us to, and we are to be spreading the truth of Jesus and his gospel. We have a mission. We've already been told to move. And it takes unity within the body to be truly successful in that mission. I can't do it all by myself. You can't do it all by yourself. We work together as the body of Christ. See, before Jesus ascended to heaven, take his place at the right hand of the Father, we see that he left his family, the church, with this task. In Matthew 28, 19 and 20, Jesus commanded that we go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the age. We were told to move. We were told to go. And we are to go out into the nations, making disciples of them, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and to teach them everything that God has commanded us to do. Jesus left this mission to the church, and it is our job as the body to be unified in this task, utilizing every gift, moving when God tells us to move in order to finish the race with success. Preaching Today once told how in Palestine today it is still possible to witness a scene that Jesus almost certainly saw 2,000 years ago, that of shepherds bringing their flocks home from the various pastures they have grazed during the day. Often, those flocks will end up at the exact same watering hole around dusk so that they will get all mixed up. 8 or 9 small flocks turning into a convention of thirsty sheep, to be frankly honest. Their shepherds, though, they don't worry about the mix-up, however. When it is time to go home, each one issues his or her own distinct call, a special thrill or whistle or a particular tune on a particular reed pipe, and the shepherd's sheep withdraw from the crowd and follow their shepherd home. They know whom they belong to. They know their shepherd's voice, and it is the only voice they will follow. Brothers and sisters, as the church, when God says move, we must be faithful and move. Just as the sheep in the story know their shepherd's voice and move when he calls them to come to him, likewise, we must be willing to do the same so that the world will come to know not only God's voice as well, but his glory, his salvation. So whatever your quirks are, whatever your talents may be, there is always a place in the church for you to put those gifts into action so that we can reach the lost. No one in the church is without value. Everyone has been gifted some way by the Lord to reach some specific people group that I could never possibly think to reach. Because you all have relationships with other people I don't know. And I have relationships with those that you don't know. And we can reach them together as the church. We need to work together in unity so that we can hear God's voice and move into action when God calls us to move his plans forward. However, before we finish for today, there is just one more extremely important key point we can pull from Exodus chapter 40, which is presented in verse 37, which is much like the last one. When God says stay, we stay. Now, kind of a no-brainer. So just like with the previous key point, here we see a similar action being taken. Yes, Israel is supposed to submit and be obedient to the Lord and move when God tells them to. Of course, they are to do that. But likewise, they are also to be obedient and submit to the Lord and stay when he tells them to stay. When the cloud sits right there over the tabernacle, they weren't supposed to go anywhere. Again, this is an extension of Israel's position and relationship with the Lord as they live in covenant with God as their king. In listening and staying when the Lord says so, the people can display their complete and utter obedience, submission, faith, trust, loyalty, love, and love for the Lord. He has saved and redeemed them out from the bonds of slavery. He has elevated them above all the other nations by making a covenant with them. The Lord has displayed and proven that he alone is worthy, holy, all-powerful, loving, and righteous, who alone is worthy of Israel's worship, praise, and loyalty. Through obedient submission and by actively staying when God says stay, the people are displaying just how much they trust God to know what's best for them. I think Acts chapter 16, verses 6 through 15, helps us to better understand this when we see how Luke shows us that Paul's second missionary journey did not start off as well as Paul would have hoped it would. As they began traveling, we come to see that not just once, but twice, the Holy Spirit intervenes. The Lord purposely stops Paul from pursuing the ministry he was wanting to pursue. You see, Paul was wanting to bring the gospel to Asia at this time. However, the Holy Spirit had other plans. This is a perfect example of the Holy Spirit slamming certain doors shut by telling Paul to stay and wait for a moment. In fact, this is a perfect example for us to learn from as we try to reach others for the Lord as well. And boy, can this be a frustrating lesson to learn at times. It's not easy to stay when God tells us to stay, especially as Americans, because our lives are all about move, 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 move. Go, go, go. Be on time. Well, sometimes God says, just take a break. Wait, stay. And it's frustrating for us. Just put yourself in Paul's shoes for a moment. He wants to go to Asia, but the Lord says no. He then tries to go to Bithynia, which is in northern Asia, but again the Lord says no. Paul and his companions want to go one way. They want to pursue ministry, but they are wanting to do it according to their plans and not the Lord's. I can only imagine that Paul and his companions are standing there frustrated and scratching their heads thinking, "Why, Lord?" Have you ever asked that question? Why? Why don't you want us to go and share the gospel in Asia? They must have been thinking this. Have you ever been there before? God, why can't I do it this way? In which you're trying to pursue ministry, even though the Lord keeps saying no? And my experience, life gets very difficult when we try to push through God's closed doors. Webb Garrison explains it like this. He says, "In several ancient cultures, the ox was commonly used to plow fields and pull carts. Proverbially stubborn, these animals were hard to handle under the best of circumstances. When a sullen bull stiffened the muscles of his powerful neck, it was difficult or impossible to guide him." The Hebrew people employed an expression meaning stiff-necked to identify people who were as defiant and self-willed as oxen. This descriptive term was used both literally and figuratively in Scripture. As a result, it remains alive and well even today, long after the use of ox power died in Western society. Are you being stiff-necked? You see, God places his yoke upon us not to increase our burdens, but to relieve it. So don't stiffen your neck to God and his leading in your life. Instead, listen to the Holy Spirit. For when God says stay, we stay, because God already has it all figured out. He's telling us to stay for a reason. Just like when he tells us to move, he's telling us to move for a reason. But the harder one for us is to learn to be patient and stay when he says stay. You know, we constantly do that. But I could be doing this, or I could go here. Now, when he says stay, that doesn't mean you don't do ministry where you're staying. but you don't move till he says move. It's even funny that actually coincides really close with the time that I came here. I was in Boise doing ministry at a different church. Ashton already knew what the Lord was wanting. I wasn't getting the picture. Something in my heart was saying, you still have to do something here. And Ray had tried and tried and tried and tried, and I had to keep just dodging him. Ray, no, it's not. God's telling me something. Finally, there was a day I drove to the office, and I was praying as I was driving with my eyes open. Don't worry, I didn't close my eyes. And all of a sudden, Ray's voice and everything he kept doing was a thought in my mind, and I asked the Lord, is now the time? And the heavy feel on my heart said, time to go. So I got to the office and called Ray and started the process. And I can never be happier with listening to the Lord and coming when he tells me to come, because now you are all a part of my family as well. We have to learn to listen to the Lord. Sometimes he says stay, and then sometimes he tells us to move. But the hardest one is when we are asked to stay and be patient, because we as people, we just aren't very patient. The funny thing with that whole story is when I called my wife, she said, it's about time you finally listened. It's like, okay. Seems like she's always known before me anytime I've done anything for the ministry. She loves to say, it's about time you finally listened. And she's right. See, the Holy Spirit does in fact have a reason for what he is doing in our lives. When he says no, we should submit to his will, not fight against it. Even though Paul and his companions don't see God's purpose, in verses 8 and 9 of Acts, we are shown that God is closing the doors for a reason. It says in verse 8, and passing by Mysia, they came down to Troas. A vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia was standing and appealing to him and saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. God sees that the Macedonians, they're ripe for the picking, and he wants Paul to go there instead. It's not like God doesn't want Asia to be reached with the gospel, because later on we learn that the gospel did in fact go to them. It's just not at this time. Macedonia was ripe for the picking. The fact is, God's timing is perfect and often different than ours. Have you ever thought of that? Like, really just pondered that concept, that God's timing is perfect. First, have to remember that. And then it's often different than ours, because he sees the larger picture. We sometimes are just stuck looking through the little keyhole. And his wisdom is greater than anything we could ever imagine. So what we see taking place is that currently in Paul's travels, God knows that Macedonia, they need healing. And because of that, we see that the Lord takes action. The Holy Spirit shuts the door to Asia in order to send Paul and his companions somewhere else, in which we learn that Paul and his group do submit to the Lord's will. When God said stay, they stayed. And as the result of listening to the Holy Spirit, Paul and his companions are now able to listen to God's plan and continue their journey according to God's will by making their way to Macedonia and ultimately to Lydia and her family. See, when they stay, they can finally start listening. When we finally submit to the Lord, and when God says stay, we stay. Well, that's when we choose to do that, when we choose to submit, that is when some of the best opportunities to share God's glory with others appear. Think about it. It's okay to take some time when God says, wait, to pray with him, to seek him out. so that we can be doing things according to his will and not our own. And oftentimes that's the best opportunity in which his plan becomes a whole lot clearer and we can see better how we can share God's glory with others. For when God says stay and we listen, it is often the best time in which his plan is the clearest. An unknown author once shared a story titled, "You'll Find Jesus There," that I think helps us to tie this all together. It starts by saying, "Tomorrow morning, I'll open up your heart," the surgeon said to the 8-year-old boy. "You'll find Jesus there," the boy said. The surgeon continued, "I'll open your heart and check the damage." "You'll find Jesus there," the boy said. "When I see the damage, I will suture you back up and then think about the next step," said the surgeon. "You'll find Jesus in my heart because my Sunday school teacher told me so. She said that the Bible says so. Besides that, our Sunday school songs say he lives there," said the boy. The surgery took place the very next day. After the surgery, the surgeon began to make notes of what he had found. In his mind, there was no hope and no cure. The little boy would die within a matter of months. The thought began to get to the doctor, and suddenly the doctor shouted to God, "Why did you do this to this boy? Why can't he live a normal life?" God spoke to the surgeon's heart and said, "The boy is a part of my flock, and I will always be a part of my flock. When he is with me, there will be no more suffering and pain. He will have comfort and peace. One day his parents, as well as you, will join him, and my flock will continue to grow." The next day, the surgeon went to the boy's room and sat down with the parents beside the bed. In the moment or two, the boy opened his eyes and asked this very question, "What did you find in my heart?" With tears flowing down his cheeks, the surgeon said, "I found Jesus there." This story helps us to remember that we all as Christians need to let God lead according to his will and his timing until we reach our promised land. As the Lord told the doctor in this story, the promised land is waiting for us. And one day, we who make Jesus Lord of our lives will all come to our promised land according to God's timing and not our own. So in the meantime, as we wait, let us continue to be faithful, knowing that God is both holy and near to us. Being faithful to move when God says move and to stay when God says stay. Simply put, let your faith be in action by letting God lead according to his will and his timing until we reach the end of the race and enter into our promised land. Will you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word and your teaching, Lord. We just ask that you will help us to be faithful, to never forget, Lord, that you are a holy God, but you are also very near to us. Father, help us to be faithful in moving when you ask us to move and to stay when you ask us to stay. Help us ultimately to be faithful and let you be the one who leads us by your timing, your will, and your way. And Father, we look forward to the day, whether it's through Jesus' second coming or we go to see you before that. Father, we look forward to the promised land that's coming, in which we will be with you for all eternity, without pain, without fear, just love with our Savior and the body of Christ together. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as the praise team starts making their way forward, I want to offer an invitation. We have talked about a few interesting things, and a lot of them with this invitation, if you already have Jesus as Lord of your life, you can make right now in your seat as you're sitting there or standing as we will stand here soon and say, "Lord, I haven't been faithful in some of these things, but I'm sorry and I want to be." That's a decision you need to make in your own heart, your own walk with the Lord. And I strongly encourage you to make that decision if you have found that, yeah, just haven't been listening. You haven't been faithful in moving when God asked you to move, or staying when he asked you to stay. Or if you haven't even been acknowledging the fact that, go, Lord, you are holy, and I haven't been treating you as you deserve, but yet you are near to me and you want me to be in relationship with you. Make those changes. But if you happen to be here and Jesus isn't Lord of your life, and you are ready to have the holy God of all creation be very near to you, make that decision today. Anytime during this song, you're welcome to come forward. We would love to usher you into the family of God together as the church. And last but not least, just a reminder, this is a safe place. It's okay to be broken here. It's okay to not have it all figured out. We as the church are here to help each other. Just as the church is made up of all different gifts, there are people here with very good gifts to help, love, and walk you through whatever you might be struggling with. And just so you do know, if you haven't placed membership in this body specifically, you're welcome to do that. You can come forward anytime during this song as well. So will you please stand as we sing this song? Be seated. I really like that song. Nothing more truer than he will save you. He will save you now. We got some trivia. Where did John Mark leave the two missionaries, Barnabas and Saul, for Jerusalem? Where did? Perga. That caused some issues later on. Was that the only one? Huh? My goodness. Well, my wife has been busy. So I guess we got to have some grace and mercy. I could start just spouting out a few. Doesn't mean I know the answer, but. All right, I got some praises and prayer concerns here. Okay, so Levi's asking prayers for all the families in Hawaii right now. They're dealing with a massively bad fire, and I think when I looked at it this morning, they at least knew of 80 that have died, and they're still not sure. They're needing people to help go through all of the wreckage, and they even described it as looking like as if a nuclear bomb had gone off the way everything looks. Granted, they're probably over-exaggerating that somewhat, but I saw some pictures. It didn't look good. Lots of homes just destroyed. So prayers for them. Also, prayers for Doug he's not having a very good time right now with his health, so be praying for Doug. And also they have a praise that the work on their house will be done. It's going to get done soon. If you didn't know, they dealt with massive flooding throughout the winter time, so praise the Lord that they're finally getting that stuff all squared away. Also, please pray for the, it's a family of Carmelita's friend. Pray for the family of her friend, Lenny Vega. Did I say that right? She has passed away yesterday morning, so the family's, they're going to be grieving very hard, so be praying for them as they go through this time of grief. And also prayers for MJ. She's not doing very well right now at all, and so prayers for her getting through all of that. And let's see here. Okay, we did that one already. Is it this side, Dale, that you gave me? Okay. Scott Hollins, Hollis. Yep, just correct me. I'm horrible with names. It's not that I don't care. Carol Hollis is going in for an angiography on Wednesday. So be praying for Carol. And then please pray for the Bill Jepson family. Jepson. Okay. Annie Jepson. Huh? Amy. Thank you. Amy Jepson passed away from cancer. Her funeral will be this Saturday in Enterprise. She was 35 and leaves her husband and three girls. So that's not going to be easy. That's going to be very hard for the family. So prayers for the family as they grieve through this and figure out how life is going to be different. And all those who know Carol and or Amy and the friends and family that are going to be at that funeral coming up this Saturday. So is there anything else? Yep, praise the Lord. Dick Temple is here, and it's good to see you. It's been far too long. Yep, and that, I'm just going to repeat what that's Jake or Jack? Jake. Jake Luttrell, right? And he, didn't they think it was something to deal with staff, some type of staff? He's basically paralyzed from the waist down. He needs our prayers, and he's got a daughter that is with him. And from what I was told, at least he has family in that area to help with watching her, but he's kind of completely unable to do anything at this point. So please pray for him as well. Yeah. Oh, praise the Lord. Okay, so prayers for your kids that they would wise up and turn to the Lord and do things His way. And also in the name of Mia is the one who's being baptized this afternoon or today, this morning, probably already part of the family. All right. We have heard everything that was said, so let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you with some prayer concerns and praises, Lord. We first and foremost, Lord, pray for those who are needing healing, who are struggling. Father, you are the great physician, and we ask that your healing hands will be upon them. Lord, and we also just pray that you would be with each one of the doctors and nurses that are helping these people, that they would be tools in your hand, and you would work through them as well. Father, I also just pray for all those who are going to be grieving, dealing with the loss of a loved one. It's never easy, Father. It never is. But we do know that you are close to the brokenhearted, Father, and that you bring peace and comfort and strength during these hard times of grief. So please be with each and every one of the family members and friends who are going to be grieving. Father, I also just want to say thank you so much for the praises that were brought up with just seeing how good you are to us, Father, to hear our prayers and to answer them. It is such an honor to just be a part of your family and see you working. It is so amazing and joy-filling to see that our God truly does love us, cares about us, hears our prayers, and acts on behalf of our prayers. We thank you so much, Jesus. It's in your holy name we pray. Amen. Will you please stand as we sing this final song?
Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on his face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel his mighty power and his grace. I can hear the rush of angels' wings. I see glory on his face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
That concludes our service. Go in peace. Have a good day.